Right, so hello and welcome back. So in the end of the last video, you saw me starting my prepared 3D, and my computer takes a little few minutes for that to process, and the next screen that presented is what you're looking at now. So you haven't lost or missed anything in between. Nothing has happened. I've just waited for this to come up, and then I've started. Pardon me, I've started recording again. I've set my, or well, Prepared 3D has set the default aircraft to be this F-22 Raptor from the 525th Fighter Squadron. And I haven't changed this, and I don't try and automate this. From here, I go in to change the vehicle, and you'll see that I have a selection of aircraft, and we're flying the Dash 8F because it's cool. And that's what we're going to fly, and then we're going to change our airport. And we're changing our airport to Dublin, of course, so it's EIDW. And we are going to select our spot. Now, most important with VATSIM is to not default onto the runway. That doesn't help anybody. But I'm going to select 411. I've tested 411. I like 411. 411 works, so we're going to go into there. We're setting our time to UTC, and we are operating at system time. So we'll set that to UTC. And yeah, I think we are nearly ready to get going, I suppose. We're an hour ahead, essentially. We have an hour still, which we'll use. For the weather, it doesn't really make a difference what you select, because once we check in with VATSIM, it's going to take over our weather and send us our weather. So that's all she wrote. So from here we'll click OK, and what will start happening now is another little bit of a load window, and a little bit of a wait as we wait for things to load up. It shouldn't take too terribly long, I hope, but it'll take a little minute or three, and then we can get ourselves up and running, I suppose. Just kind of wondering what I need to have up and running and what I don't. I try to keep the minimum on my computer going if I can manage it. The terrain that I'm loading is only the European terrain, but it is Orbix terrain, which is very, very nice. There's a lot of talk about new simulators coming out, Microsoft 2020 being the big ticket on the headlines these days, and it looks ultimately fantastic, I have to admit. But I've got no plans to move away from Prepared 3D in the medium to long term. I suppose the longer it goes, the more of a question mark becomes. But certainly in the short term, no plan, and in the medium term, no plan. Who knows what the future brings beyond that? But part of that is just I'm invested in Prepared 3D, so it doesn't make sense for me to jump into another sim. I also think that Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020 is coming out of the box looking awesome, but it's still going to take a little time to settle. So what's going on now is you can see Navigraph charts are flashing at the bottom, and what's important to do is to wait for that sound, that little air sound, to appear and disappear. This is a thing about Prepared 3D. You have to stand by for a little while just to get it to a point where it goes through its initialization and its startup. And we kind of bounce around the cockpit here a little bit. So I have TrackIO running, which allows me to look around the cockpit. I also have a TrackIO pause button, which will do that. And now it's locked my head movement. Then I have some buttons with EasyDock set up so that I can look at the panel above. This is the pedestal. I can move and look at the FMCs up front. I can come down and have a look also at the what you call it. The electronic flight bag, which this is. I can pop over and sit in the co-pilot's or first officer's seat. I can pop outside and have a look at what's going on out here. And I can pop back into the thing. So there are the views that I've set up at the moment. There's many, many more views that are possible. One other one that I've started working with is this view from the tail at the back of the aircraft that I can look around on. But at the end of the day, user's taste and all the rest is what's going to drive that. Okay, so what's gone on? What else has been opened up? Well, as you remember from the SIM starter in the last video, I mentioned that there was a number of programs that started up. So the first amongst these is this, which is the NaviCharts tool. Now, this is a purchasable subscription-based thing. So I'm going to pick this flight, which is 004, that we've created. And this is going to show us our actual route from taking off at the runway to climbing out to getting into our flight plan, all the various waypoints along the way, plus their routes. Gives a lot of information, gets us across into mainland Europe, flies us down here into Vienna, past Wagram towards Fischerment. And you have Bruch an der Leithe and all the rest here. You have Vienna, which is not too terribly far away from the airport. It's just inside here a little bit. It doesn't show up so well. So this information is nice for flight planning. And the beauty about it is that it kind of gives fairly up-to-date waypoints and things that are looking good. Now, I do have a couple of questions that have appeared in the flight plan thing. One important thing is it's not for navigational use. It's not for real-world navigation. This is very much just for flight planning, but it's a pretty kind of nice tool to have, really, and a lot of people do use it. One of the other devices that has popped up here, and this is the important one from the VATSIM perspective, is a tool called vPilot. And what vPilot does is it allows us to connect to the VATSIM network. Now, right now I'm not connected, but once I hit connect, I will be. In the flight plan here, I have some information that has been previously put in. We're flying an IFR from Dublin to Vienna with Bratislava as an alternate. Our departure time is now going to change to 15:20. So we will update that. We're expecting the flight to take about 2 hours 45 minutes. And we can look at our endurance by doing the following. Let me do this. We need power. We need the power. We don't have the power. So we can turn on the battery or we can turn on the external power. So I'll turn on the external power. That'll give us two runs of power coming in. And we wait for this to fire up. So I can click on that. What I might do is actually increase the size of this so that it's nice and big for the few occasions that we will be bringing it up and having a gawk at it. Could do with just expanding it a little bit. Right. So in here I have documents, and within the documents I should be able to thought I had my flight plan here somewhere. Oh, that's not... Hang on a minute. Documents. Dang it. Bear with me for a second. We'll fix this. I thought I'd put this into there in the appropriate place. Open file location. Copy. Common. That. Is that all of that? That's the introduction and all the rest. Common. Let's put it into common. Let's see if that works. We might need to do a refresh of the system. So we'll do a quick restart. This will only take a minute. So what we want to do is to understand what our available flight information would be. So that's why I'm popping in here. There's our flight plan. Cool. So now I can share this on the screen with you as I go through it. Just increase the size ever so a little bit. So it looks like we have a release fuel of 5 hours and 28 minutes. So we won't need all of that unless we get terribly long. But 5 hours and 28 minutes is what we have. Our cruise is going to be set for about 492 airspeed, and we're cruising at 35,000 feet. We're a heavy aircraft, and this information here, I'm just going to pull from the next page, which is here. So this is Liffey to, let me just pull that up and see, does it match? Liffey Q36 to Epoxy L15 to Big, UL9 to Conan, 607 to Matug, 660 to Raspu, UL940K, Donrad, Diddly Diddly. Wondering about this particular stuff here, if that's something that is of worry. Then it's 924 to Roca, C401, LMB76 Bitis, T35 Makov. Okay, so this is the same as we've got in here, so that's very good. I've put in a remark for me being a new pilot. My equipment suffix is L. You can look that up on the web yourself, but it's basically down to what kind of equipment do you have on board with respect to the accuracy with which you can follow a path, and it helps the ATC determine how close they can stack aircraft together. So from here then, we would go ahead and we would file this flight plan. So we're not connected to the network, so that's going to be a problem. Our connection is now established, we can go into the flight plan and we can file the flight plan again. So it says our flight plan is filed, which is mucho buenos. We're going to reduce that again just for a while because we don't need it up. And if we pop out to our externals now, we can see behind us that there's an airline. This is an airline that is flown by somebody else. And we can have a look and see what's going on. We won't be able to reverse because we are probably in the way right now. But if we pop over to our Vatastic real quick, and we wait and scroll around until we get to Ireland, we can see that that aircraft is in there, EJ Thorpe, and we're not there yet, but let me do a refresh and see, do we pop up. Retrieve the new information, the map is loading, take a moment, dismiss. So this is if you enjoy this, whatever, get into using it. And now if we pop into Ireland, we will see that there's two aircraft here. There's myself, and behind me is EJ Thorpe. So we are online. This is for real. Oh yeah, the equipment stuff that I talked about. We've got transponder in mode C, which we have. And this link will allow you to kind of read through a lot of information about the equipment type and choosing the equipment code. And it's all in the Pilot Resource Center for VATSIM. It refers to Squawk Box and FSN. These are old tools. VPilot is now the standard typical tool that people are using. So that's that. I will kill that because I don't really need to go any further with it. What else do I have open here? If we scroll down to our thing, we have VPilot, we have Active Sky, Track IOR, prepared 3D itself, and that's it. So that's it. So now we need to go ahead and actually set up our flight and do a few, three or four things based on our flight plan that we had set up here previously. So the first thing that I tend to do is for fun is go to this central flight management computer, and I go into FS Actions and I go into doors, and basically I open the entry door, which is now opening. You can hear it. And then basically I open all the doors and the side cargo door as well. If I clicked it. Did I click it? I might not have. I don't bother opening the nose, but we could open the nose if we so wished. We're on electrical power, so I'm pretty sure that should open. If I crane my neck a little bit and press the doors function, we can see that these are the doors that are open right now. We've got the forward overhead, and we've got the entry one. This is the main door we get in and out of. And then we have the upper deck and the forward cargo, the aft cargo, the aft bulk. I want to open the side door. And I might need to have my battery on for that. And see if that is enough to drive that. Ach. There's a trick to opening this, and I thought it was electrical power was necessary. The other thing that we can do, we've got the APU bleed on. Let's start the APU. That's no harm. Set that back to aux, it should be. And we'll set our beacon on as well so that anybody who's around should know that we're there. We're just going to wait now for our APU to start, and we'll be able to get these two signs here. And I might need to turn on the APU generator one and leave external power two on when that actually starts. So that's available. So we'll turn on APU Gen 1, and then we will pop back here and see if that's enough to open this door, and it is. So we're now opening that cargo door, and we see that this side cargo door has opened. Bueno. So for fun, we're going to call our ground crew folks, and we're going to request boarding operations. So that'll just add a little bit of activity outside for the fun of it. For here, with the fuel and the payload, this is where we're going to need to bring up this tool again. And let's see if we can have both of them together. Just about. Might just scrunch this ever so slightly. And if we go to the appropriate next page, we'll be able to get our fuel, which was down here. So for fuel, we are taking a release fuel of 119,279. So we will type that in. 119,279. And we will put that in for the fuel. And that's our fuel setup. So then we can return. And we can go to our ground operations. No, not our ground operations. It is ground services. And we can request the fuel truck to come along and fill us up. Again, just for fun. Yeah, that's all we're doing here. Our ground connections, incidentally, we have the power in, and we could get air conditioning in as well. We actually have air conditioning and ground in. That'll save us our packs. Okay, so that's the activity that is going on there, underway. And if we pop out really quickly, we can see that there's various services coming along to sort out our activity. We've got an aircraft taking off over our head, which is This is what blows my mind. There's actually a person flying that. Yeah, it's a simulator, but they're actually there. They're actually in the process of climbing out of Dublin right now, which is kind of neat. In the background, you can see various vehicles running around, and they're going off to pick up some of the cargo that they'll bring back. So there's a bit of activity going on there for a little while. Got a maintenance van or something coming up here as well, do we? He's hammering it around. Hey, cheeky, he cut inside the cone there. Did you see that? So whilst that's all going on, we have a little bit of setup that we need to start doing. So the first thing that we need to start doing is getting ourselves established on the FMC. We are a 747-8. Oh, there is something else that we can do that I forgot about, and that is we can start our alignment. So we can start our alignment, and by starting the alignment, it means that we can start getting our navigation system set up and ready to go. So you can see that time to align is 7 minutes, so that's all going to start, which is good. That's a good thing to do. So this is the information that we have on our navigation system, which is good up until the 23rd of April. These are our engines, standard stuff. I'm no expert at this, by the way, so I'm just going to go with what I think I know. The airport that we're at is here at Dublin, and the gate that we're at is 411 that I'm aware of. Now, we could go to Fix and we can pick up our GPS when we get that, or we can pick the GPS out of there by clicking it once it appears at the bottom, and then we click on the line that we want to put it in, and that's our GPS position setup. We still need to wait about 7 minutes for our alignment to work and for our data links to set up. But in the meantime, we have our origin that we can type in again, and we do need to do this a couple of times. And we are going to LOW. That is our destination. So the runway we're expecting is runway 10 out of Dublin, so we'll type that in. And then we will type in our flight identifier, which is Charlie Lima X-ray 258. So that's it. So we need to select our route in a moment, so that we can activate that and set all that up. And in order to do that, we would need to establish our data link. So we would click on data link, and we would click on pre-flight, and we would again type in some of this general information, just so that we can tie stuff together. Now, the reason we're doing this is not 100% clear to me, other than it is a simulation of the real-world operating mode and how things are going. So our estimated time for departure is 15:20, and our estimated time for arrival would be 18:08, I believe. And the airline is CV for Cargolux. So that is our flight number, which is what we have. And now we're just waiting for the data link to establish. And we're doing this realistic real time, so we still have 7 minutes of a wait for this to get established. In the meantime, we can go back here and we can look at our terminal charts. Let me bring this up so it's a little bit easier to view. This would get automatically pulled in as well, but I'm just going to do it this way for now. If we open up the airport here, we can see our airport layout. We're in the south apron around about here, 411. And if I scroll in on this, we'll be able to see that we have our taxiways Bravo 1, past Link 1 to Bravo 2, and then on to Sierra. and it goes up to Sierra 7. Sierra 6 and 5 look like they're high speed exits. Sierra 3 is as well. Sierra 4 is optional. Sierra 2 would be an exit if you were coming in and landing in the direction we will be taking off on. But Sierra 7 is our hold short to join runway 10. So our taxiway is going to bring us straight down here, and it shouldn't be too complicated. Runway 16 and 34 are not operational right now because the wind, as we saw in our preparation, is coming from 110 at 10 knots, I believe. In fact, we can very quickly go and check that right now. So in here, if I type in, it is 124.525, I believe.
00 feet. Temperature 11. Dew point 7 QNH 1022. No significant change. Advise on initial contact, you have information, Charlie.
This is the ATIS.
This is IWO information, Charlie. At time 1300, expect ILS approach runway 10 in use. Transition level 60. Wind 100 degrees 11 knots, variable between 060 and 150 degrees. Visibility 10 kilometers, clouds. Few clouds at 1200 feet, broken 2600 feet. Temperature 11. Dew point 7 QNH 1022. No significant change. Advise on initial contact, you have information, Charlie.
So our information is Charlie. We'll listen to this once more.
This is IWO information, Charlie. At time 1300, expect ILS approach runway 10 in use. Transition level 60. Wind 100 degrees 11 knots, variable between 060 and 150 degrees.
Okay,
we'll visibility 10 kilometers.
So what we've got is wind from 100, so it's coming straight down the runway, and it's at 11 knots. So that's the situation when it comes to the wind. Basically the wind is coming from 110, which is straight down this runway, basically. Or 100, actually. Is it 100? Yeah. So it's coming straight down this runway. So this runway is runway 10. You can see underneath it that its actual line is 098 degrees. So they use the first... They rounded up to the nearest kind of cardinal point on the compass, so to speak. So they're not going to write 098. They'll call it runway 10. Runway 16 is actually 160 degrees exactly, so there's no rounding up there. So they use the first two numbers of the runway. Runway 34 consequently is on 34, but 28 is actually 278. But for ease of talking about it, they run. Now, a quick way to find out the opposite of runway 34, if this wasn't written up here as runway 16, is a rule called plus 2 minus 2, or the opposite of minus 2 plus 2 rule. If you have a number here of 34, runway 34, mainly 340 degrees, you can use a plus 2 minus 2 rule or a minus 2 plus 2 rule to work out the absolute opposite. Because this is 300 up here, I will start with a minus 2 plus 2 rule. So minus 2 from 3 leaves 1, plus 2 to 4 makes 6. So 34 with the minus 2 plus 2 rule gives you runway 16. That's kind of pretty cool how that works. Yeah. You could use a plus 2 minus 2. So let's do it with runway 28. And we're doing it with the 28 and not with the 278. So if we could do it with the 278 as well, actually. Let's do it with the 278. So in this case, we are going to do a plus 2 minus 2. Yeah. If we added plus 2, if we're doing it with the 278, we're only talking about the first two numbers with this rule, right? So the last number doesn't ever change. So the 8 is always going to be there. So the last number is going to be 8, but what are the first numbers going to be? Well, we're going to use a plus 2 minus 2 rule in this particular case. So in this particular case, 278, well, we plus 2 and we minus 2, we're going to get 478. because we've added 2 to the first number and taken 2 away from the second number. So excuse me, it's going to be 4, 5, 8, not 4, 7, 8. 4, 5, 8. Now 4, 5, 8 is more than 360. So we kind of have to take away 360. And remember, the last number we're not going to do anything from. So we end up with 458 minus 360. We end up with 098. And that's this number down here, 098, which we round up to runway 100 or runway 10, as the colloquialism is. Anyway, I just wanted to talk about that for a minute whilst we're waiting for the ILS to connect. So we're down to 1 minute. Actually, we're not. We've just seen them if you were watching. The left, center, and the right have all gone to zero, so we have an ILS align. So as I go up here, I can switch these over to nav. Which means that if I go back down here now, and we wait for a moment, we will be able to get our data link coming up, he says. There's our data link, which has popped up. So we are now going to data link connect. And we are data link synchronizing right now, and we're getting a couple of chimes to tell us that stuff is happening. So that data link is now getting synchronized. We can go back to our FMC up here, and we're going to wait for our route select to occur. So I can click route select now, and I have a generic in here, but I also have 3 of the 747 ones that are in here, but I want this one, I know, so I'm going to select that, and I'm going to make the request, and the request is sending. So this is simulating the pilot sending a request for his route information from the central office, and now we have it. The route uplink has been established, so we can load it. And now the route 1 uplink is loading. And yeah, things are going fairly well. I'm just keeping an eye on my information here with VATSIM, and I think we're okay. I haven't turned on a mode C yet because I'm not really ready to go. We'll do that a little closer to the time. So we... what's that? Do we have a message coming up? We might have a message from the ground services. Are the ground services finished? Well, he's driving away with his stuff. Those cargo loaders have loaded up there. There's the rest of that, I think, is being done. Wait. Look back here, we don't see anything. Okay. Okay. So we've loaded that, so we can activate that by clicking activate, and we can click execute to execute it, and then we can go into our performance initialization, and this is telling us that we have 695.1, fuel 119.2, a zero fuel weight of 575.9, reserve of 24.9, flight level of 370 is in there with a fuel cost index of that, and center of gravity of 20. So what I can do here now is go to menu, go to performance, copy in the FMC information, which is giving us some information here for the runway. We're going to select as runway 10. The condition is dry. The wind is, we need to bring up our keyboard here, and the wind is 100. The outside temperature is that. Yeah, the wind is too high. Well, that would make sense. The wind is 11, Jack. So it can deal with me being an idiot. And the Q and H is 1022. I want to say that's correct. It is 1022. Yeah, that's what was there. We are going for a takeoff with a flaps 10 configuration with the air conditioning off and the anti-ice is off. So if we do a calculation on that, it's going to come up with some numbers for us here, and it's going to suggest that we have a V1 of 153, a VR of 170, and a V2 of 168. That's our safe climb out. That's going on there. I suppose I need to type in my takeoff weight here, and my takeoff weight based on my flight plan is 1 minute, bear with me. We are firing up our pad here again because I just closed it down. But our takeoff weight was fairly heavy. Ba-da-ba-da-bum. 788907. Click on it. 788907. And that was calculating a center of gravity automatically for us? No, it didn't. For some reason, we have a cell temperature of 43, and we have these numbers now, which are a slight improvement. I am wondering if we have a center of gravity of 20, it says. So we'll copy that over here and then do the calculation again and see if those numbers are any different. So that's what we've got for our performance. We are going to be flying flight level. Oh, I've done it again. Oh, no, I haven't. Flight level 350 is our planned flight for the entire flight. So I'm going to change that to 350. Perflink update. Yeah, whatever. We have a flight level of 350 to put in here, which it doesn't want to take for some reason. Well, we can accept that and then we can change it. The wind is ready, that's fine. Our fuel was a total of, these are on different pages here, so I have to scroll and I have to do it carefully. Our fuel was 119.2, so that's absolutely correct. Which was nice for it to brought in. Roger, roger. Our gross weight is 695. Our zero fuel weight, they're low. They're low. Our zero fuel weight is 671.2. Our gross weight is a little higher at 799 as opposed to 788. 790, 788. I'm okay with that. And I'm okay with everything else, so that's good. Yeah, we have wind uplink. We'll worry about that in a moment. Our cell temperature was 43, so this is kind of telling the engines essentially what to work on. We've selected full takeoff power, so that's fine. And if we get over to the takeoff numbers, we are putting in a flap 10 takeoff, with a center of gravity that was 22 now, interestingly. And we are takeoff gross weight. Well, we need to work out what the departure is first, so we'll come back to that. So the departure is on runway 10. Well, we actually don't know this for sure, but we can imagine what we're going to get back from our folks at air traffic control. The expectation is that they're going to give us a Kish 2 Foxtrot, and that is going to be the takeoff stuff for the departure. And even for the arrival, we're pretty sure that we're going to be coming in on runway 16 on Mykov 7 Whiskey. So we will select that as well. And then the winds, we can uplink the winds. Let's load them because they're available. The request is sent. We'll execute on that. And then we have the route here that is set up and good. And we have the legs, and we need to click through these to see if there's any issues or any tissues, namely with discontinuities, and there's one there. So we'll highlight the discontinuity below the discontinuity and then add above. So that's all taken care of there. And then we have that set up there. We have a little bit of a flight limitation that we would need to probably put in as well, but we'll deal with that in a minute. Looks like we have the forecast that we can upload as well. So we click on that and click on load and wait for that to invalid forecast uplink. Send request. Descent forecast. Sent. And then load. Invalid. So it's maybe too early or something to... Something's not working there, so... we will worry about that a little bit later. But right now we have set up our departures for this particular routing, and we can see on our screen here that we do have that takeoff, and it is curving away a little bit, so that's all looking fairly good. Yeah. Okay, just going to pop into the wonderful internet for a moment here, and we're going to look at Vatastic again, just to see what the numbers are, because I haven't, oh, there's nobody in Dublin, but there is somebody here covering the whole region. And that's going to be Adrian Chin out of Galway here, or Shannon, that's running that entire sector. Departures, Mark Doyle. Yeah. So we don't have anybody in Dublin. Really new. Okay. So on our radios, if we are not, if we go to the VATSIM Unicom, it's 122.8. So we have a new codec and things as well, which I wonder, do I have to do anything? .122.8 is the Unicom code. So we will go to 122.8. Flip that over and have a listen. And there's not going to be anybody talking on 122.8. But there's nobody on Dublin either. There's just centers and stuff that are set up, so we will turn on our mode C. Actually, we won't turn that on just yet. That's the wrong thing to turn on anyway. It's down here is the mode C. We do need to get a squawk, and we do need to get a few little bits and pieces established for ourselves before we get out. So yeah, let's go back to our thrust information, and we have these filled in now, 177, which is good on that climb out, which is fine. So that's bueno. Go over to progress over here. Well, we need to go into the FMC first. Go into progress over here. Right, there's a few things that we need. We have a 6,000 transition, which is that there now. We have a 177 climb out, so we're going to set that there. We have a 10 degree runway heading. It's 9.8, but it's close enough to 10. We also need to set our Q and H, and that Q and H is 30.18, so it's really high pressure today. So we do that here, and we just move it around until we get 30.18, and that is the local pressure, which is all very well and good. So somebody is passing flight level 100 for 3,000 feet, so that's fine. I might actually have to send some messages myself here, rather than just start off. If we have a top-down view, we'll see if there's anybody behind me, and there are aircraft behind me. So it's not just a simple case of do whatever you want, like. We are going to, so it said it's waiting for our action to close entry one and prepare for pushback and stuff, okay. Fair enough. So if we pop out and we look around, we do have doors open all over the place. But other than that, I think we're not too shabby. And in terms of time, we're about 15 minutes away, so we need to get a bit of a move on. So what we can do here is we can go back to our main menu here and go to FX Actions and go to the doors. And we can close all the doors. And most of them will close without any drama, because we are on power and we can see them all closing down there slowly. And these guys are all moving away. And over here, the doors are all closed down, so we're not doing too shabby. That's all closed. So that is Very good. So if they're all closed, then we are in good shape. For our ground connections, we can release the power and we can release the air conditioning, which is good. And for our service vehicles, we can release the fuel truck and have him go away. We can pull our handbrake and release the chocks as well. That's good. So fuel, payload, all of that is pretty much done. So then we are in a position probably to get ready to push back.